Welcome to my Texas workshop. I'm Randy Lammers.
I'm Aaron Keevan.
This is Worth Knowing. Do you fully understand structural joints and what's needed to assemble them? Let's start with some basics on structural bolting. Chris, thank you for being here again. Greatly appreciate that, being part of the show.
I'm glad you let me come back a second time. I may hang around for a while.
Oh, you're welcome. So let's start with how bolts work. And we have taught you this in episodes 1 and 2. If you haven't seen that, please go back and watch those episodes. But to kind of recover it, they operate like a coiled spring. When I put tension on this, I stretch the steel, and the steel wants to go back to its original length. That creates a clamping load. So just like a coiled spring works, that's how bolts work. A lot of people don't understand that. And it's all about creating that stretch and where it let it go back to its original length.
Absolutely. And keep in mind, too, that the use of bolts really came specifically in these structural structures. That's a hard thing to say.
It is.
It was essentially to replace hot rivets, because once the rivets were put in, they were fixed and they were firm. But we all know that metal is a malleable material, right, and it's going to change based on your conditions and what's going on. So bolts really became a much safer and easier option because you can account for that in the design phase and get a more uniform product, as opposed to the rivets that were done all on site and all had those little differences.
Yeah, no, that makes good sense. So good thing for the threaded fastener. So let's talk about the different joint designs. So we have snug tight, we have pre-tensioned, and we have slip critical. Let's start with snug tight.
Yes, sir. So snug tight is essentially, that's really gonna come into factor when you're talking about a shear connection. Where all you want to do is make sure that those plates aren't going to work against each other, that they're not going to slip. So that's really where a snug tight connection is going to be okay. Common example would that be kind of verticals in a metal building situation, where the only real effect on that joint is going to be gravity.
Okay.
And you just want to keep it in place.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yes, sir.
Okay, what about pre-tension?
Pre-tension's a bit of a misnomer. It sounds like you're gonna get the bolt into tension and then you're gonna lock it in.
Yeah.
Really what it means is that you're gonna put the tension of the load on that bolt before you put the actual load of the steel together. So you're gonna bring your members together and then you're gonna get that bolt to full tension before you release the load on. That's gonna be what you see in the more complex steel structures. Your skyscrapers, your taller buildings, things like that. And that's really when your load is gonna be in both tension, where you're trying to keep the members from separating. You want that load working together as a tension connection as opposed to a strictly shear connection.
Okay, that makes good sense. So I've got my cranes that are holding the steel together. I pre-tension my bolts before I let go of the steel.
Absolutely, because again, you're not gonna use your bolts to bring your steel together or to fight that resistance. It's acting as a fully compatible system where that spring action is holding what you've put together correctly already.
All right, well then one that sounds really critical to me is slip critical.
Yes, sir, slip critical sounds the most critical.
It does.
Because it really is. Slip critical means we can't allow this joint to move at all. If it's going to move, it's gotta all go together. We can't have any situation where one piece of the joint, depending on how many there are, any pieces of the joint are moving independent of the rest of that joint. That joint has to be locked in as one continuous unit.
So I have to have, then I would say, a lot of tension created in there and also resistance of shear.
Absolutely. Okay. And that's where we really get into the importance of what your surface material is, what kind of bolts you're using, and that you've followed all the proper steps in from the design phase all the way through the execution to make sure that this joint is now a solid single unit.
Okay, so lubrication, friction, all of those are important, really, and slip critical, especially friction, I would assume.
Absolutely, yes, sir.
Okay, all right. That's our different joints, and that's what we have to contend with. So each one of these joints have holes in the steel.
Absolutely.
Okay, so
how are you gonna get it together if you don't put some holes in there?
That's kind of what I figured too. There are specific requirements on these holes. I can't just punch any kind of hole in there and start putting my steel together. What are the tolerances and what do these holes have to be?
Well, fortunately, RCSC's added again. And right back to your standard.
Use your books, use your standards.
Boltcouncil.org, never forget that website.
All right.
They're gonna give you tolerances for exactly how big your bolt hole can be, what the surface conditions of your bolt holes are gonna be, and what's gonna be required depending on the joint type, depending on your structure, and what ultimately the job that you're trying to accomplish.
Okay, so I read about a 16th of an inch beyond the basic diameter is common?
That's pretty common. The AISC, the American Institute for Steel Construction, they've kind of tweaked it a little bit, and they're allowing for a little bit of a larger bolt hole right now.
Okay.
They've changed the configuration. 16th of an inch is pretty common. The most important thing is, regardless of your bolt hole size, you need to make sure that the washer and the bolts involved are the right size for that hole.
Oh, that's
right.
And
that your hole is prepared correctly.
Okay, so let's talk about the installation methods. So we have our steel, we have our joint designs, we have our tools, we have our bolts. What are the installation methods? The RCSC defines four installation methods.
Yes, sir, it really does. The calibrated wrench method, the turnip nut method, the DTI method, and the TC bolt method. Each of these have their own specifications and what you're expected to do and the steps that you're supposed to follow. But if you follow each of those steps, all of these are valid methods for getting these bolts to the proper tension.
Okay. We are going to cover each one of these methods individually in detail. So let's go to testing today on this episode on calibrated wrench.
It's all about
torque tension relationship. So let's do calibrated wrench testing.
Yes, sir.
We're back at our Skidmore load cell unit. So let's talk about calibrated wrench and what we need to do here. So it's all about friction, I know that, and every time that something changes in the friction, right?
Absolutely. So calibrated wrench is one of our four approved methods per the RCSC. With a calibrated wrench, anytime a component lot changes, if you have drastic environmental changes, if you've had storage issues, or if you change anything if you're with your tools, calibrated wrench is one of those you'd see more typically in a pneumatic application. So when you're testing these, and what we're gonna perform today is a pre-installation verification test for the calibrated wrench method.
All right.
But if we were doing this with a pneumatic tool, if we were gonna use a 100-foot hose up in the steel, we'd have to test with that 100-foot hose too, because the most important thing with the calibrated wrench method is finding our peak torque value so that we can make it repeatable.
Okay. And this has to be done a minimum at every shift, right?
Absolutely. Okay. At every shift, or when any of the components change, or there's a significant change in the environment or the temperature or really anything that changes. So this is a very controlled method that we need to make sure that is very precise.
Okay. So my understanding then, Chris, what we're going to do, we have loaded this with a three-quarter inch bolt. We are going to tension this to the indicator here for three-quarter bolts, which is 29,000 per the RCSC requirements.
Yes, sir.
So, and then we're going to observe what the torque is to get there. We're going to run three samples, and then the highest torque value it took to do that for this lot is the one we'd use in installation.
Yes, sir, with this tool.
With that tool.
Absolutely.
Okay, let's get started.
So step one, we're always going to get it to snug tight first.
Okay.
And again, that's our normal effort under the normal iron worker. Mostly when we're using these load cells, we just want to make sure that we're registering on the cell.
Okay, just get a registration on the needle. All right.
So we're at about 2.5 there. So now we know that we've gotten to snug tight.
All right, then grab our wrench that we want to use on our job site.
Yes, sir. Next, we're going to get to our calibrated wrench here. We're going to want to make sure that we zero it out.
Okay. And this is test number one.
This is test number one.
All right.
We'll call it lot assembly A.
Okay.
And we're really just looking to make sure that we're getting to the 29,000 for this 3/4 inch bolt.
Okay. A little bit more right there, 29,000 pounds. What are we reading?
Okay. Looks like we're reading it about 398.
398 foot-pounds. Okay.
Yes, sir.
We will loosen this up, put our next bolt in, and do that test.
Do it all over again.
Test number two. We already have this snug tight. So, Chris, put the wrench on there. See what our torque is.
I feel like I'm taking all the fun jobs from you.
One more time.
One more ought to get us.
OK. Okay, right there. And just a little over 2,000, 29,000 pounds.
All right, looks like we peaked there at about 350.
350, okay. 398, 350, let's do number three. We're at snug, let's do test number three and see what we get here.
Yes, sir.
Okay, a little bit more right there, 29,000 pounds. What do you read?
All right, looks about 360 that time.
360, okay, very good. So 398, 350, 360. This tells us then for this lot of bolts, that wrench today in this atmosphere, we're going to install at 398 foot-pounds.
Absolutely, so for every time you use this combination, a bolt, nut, washer,
mm-hmm.
and this wrench, today, we're gonna go to at least 398.
Okay, excellent. All right, calibrated wrench. All right, Chris, I didn't tell you this, but we were unboxing bolts. I dropped one in the mud.
Randy, we talked about storage.
I know we did, but you know what? Let's have some fun.
Okay, we're here.
We're here, and we got the load tester. Let's see what this thing does.
Absolutely.
Okay. Be honest with you, I can feel a frictional difference. But let's just see what happens, because I know these things get dropped.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, tighten her up.
So we're getting snug here. Oh. A little more effort to get to snug there that time.
Okay. Now, I took a towel. I wiped it clean. I'm telling you, it was clean. So, but it wasn't really lubricated anymore. All right, my friend.
Throw our torque wrench on here.
Let's go to 29,000, look back up here to the same mark. Ready?
Yep. Either I'm getting tired, you gave me a dirty bolt here.
Okay, you're struggling there, Chris. What's your torque?
Well, I'm at 575.
And you're only at, I'm gonna call it about 18,000 pounds. So we're supposed to go to 29,000. This lot was tested at 398 foot-pounds. You're at 500. And you're only at 18,000 pounds. You're not even close. See, my friends, friction. All I did, honestly, is I dropped it in the mud, I picked it up, I wiped it off really, really good with a towel. You couldn't see it. This is what happens to you. I did one other thing to you.
What did you do now?
Well, what happens if the weather changes and a cold front comes in? I put a bolt in the freezer. Let's see what it does.
Oh, let's see what happens.
Okay, I'll go get it. Okay, you're gonna notice that we had to add a C-clamp because that last demonstration we did where I dropped it in the mud, it welded the threads together. We had to break this in torsional, which of course pulled my apparatus out, so we had to add a C-clamp. So we have now, I took the bolt out of the freezer. Now I really only put the bolt in there. I didn't put the nut and washer in there. Mm-hmm. So we have snugged this up just for fun. Let's see what happens when we have that cold front come in and we're up in Minnesota.
Yes, sir. Let's see what kind of changes we got going on.
Okay.
If you'll watch my tension.
Okay. And you are there. What do we have?
So this time for a torque reading, I only got 325.
325, all right. So with cold, steel contracts. So that bolt is just a little bit smaller. So the same lot, we were at 398 with a cold bolt only, we're at 325. It makes a difference. That's why we recalibrate what we're gonna do when we have weather changes, we have any changes in friction. In conclusion, bolts act like coiled springs.
And when you're accounting for these, you need to make sure that you're accounting for your force load, your joint connection types, and your hole dimensions are absolutely critical.
Torque is primarily a rotational force to overcome friction. Due to potential changes in friction, wrench calibration must be done on the job site at the beginning of each shift. Types of joint design and how bolts work, that's worth knowing. Thanks again to Chris Tribble. Make sure you subscribe so you're notified of all future episodes.